brother. What's up?
This is a good recording, man.
Yeah, brother,
I can dig it.
Stop. Right on.
Hey, man, what's your name?
Brother, 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 there's far too many of you die.
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass kisser.
I seem to be inept at everything except my work. I'm good at my work, so I confine myself to that. All I want out of life is a 30 share and a 20 rating.
The man's enlarged my mind. He's a poet, warrior in the classic sense. I'm a little man. I'm a little man. He's a great man.
Think of it as colors. There's black and there's white. And in between is mostly gray. That's us. Now, gray is a tough color because it's not as simple as black and white. And for the media, certainly not as interesting. But it's who we are.
And we have nothing. Leader Fan Radio Network.
It's frustrating.
And KFAN.com. 2 minutes, 2 seconds past the hour of 3 o'clock Central Daylight Time. We welcome you back to a Friday calm before the Snownami Storm of the Century edition of the Bumper to Bumper program. On a, like I said, calm before the Snownami. From a weather standpoint, mostly sunny. Well, at least partly sunny here in the greater St. Louis Park area. My name is Dan Barrero. I host the program. Guardsy is out today. That means Brett Blakemore is in that chair. And I believe we're going the distance today. Is that correct?
Or
are we being preempted at 6 by Big Dance stuff? Last week, I think we left a half hour early for tournament stuff, but let me know because Guardsy
rarely knows.
We're going to 6:30 as far as we know?
I believe we're going the distance.
Okay, fair enough. We'll get to the Abort and Volvo guest lineup in just a minute. We have played the bit. They have everything and we have nothing many, many times over the years. And for those who aren't familiar with it, are the uninitiated, generally what we mean by that is Wisconsin has everything and we have nothing from a sports standpoint. Because so often it seems to feel that way when it comes to historically Wisconsin football. Wisconsin basketball, Green Bay Packers. I guess you could even say the Milwaukee Bucks. They won NCAA, an NBA title several years ago. I don't know if they're going to win another one, but they've won in their history two. Whatever that number is, they got more than we do. I mean, post Minneapolis Lakers, that is. And so they have everything and we have nothing bugaboo has hit us again. Now, in this case, it's not as if there is any Wisconsin team currently profiting from this particular player's success. But we come to find out, and I didn't know this, I'd never heard of the guy before last night, Big Dance, that the three-point shooting hero out of the NCAA tournament thus far for 14 seed Oakland, as in Oakland, not California, but Oakland, Michigan, is it pronounced Pewaukee? How do you pronounce Pewaukee? Is it Pewaukee? You're the Wisconsin expert on this show.
I know I'm more of a Wisconsin expert than you, maybe, but I have no idea.
He's from Pewaukee.
Pewaukee.
I think that's pretty close to the Dells. I'm not sure, but I think it's pretty close. He played at Pewaukee High School, and he has become, thus far, as I said, the number one story through the first day and night. We're heading now into day two, afternoon two, of the big dance. Jack Gaulke, is it Gaulke or Gaulke? Check the pronunciation on him. I watched the game last night. I still don't remember how it was pronounced. All I know is he made 10 three-pointers. And how does a good-looking kid from Pewaukee, Wisconsin, end up on the Oakland Golden Grizzlies football team, a basketball team that is the talk of the tournament thus far? Well, I don't know. I do know this. He's 24. He played his first five seasons at something called Hillsdale College. That's a Division II school in Hillsdale, Michigan. Redshirted as a freshman, then had the four seasons at Hillsdale before transferring to Oakland. And he is currently taking what's called in the business his COVID-related fifth season. And who knew that Pewaukee's finest would end up ascending to such a place of notoriety in the biggest of the big dances? This is exactly emblematic of why we love the tournament. We learn about who a guy is that we've never heard of. We find out, I don't know if you saw it, know this stat. This entire season, so far, season and postseason, he has taken 355 shots. 8 have not been three-pointers. 347 out of his 353 shots attempted are from three-point range. That's the definition of a three-point specialist, right? I mean, you can't be any more of a three. He makes no bones about what he is. He has no illusions about what he isn't. That's got to be the most outrageous ratio in the history of college basketball. I can't imagine we've seen ratios like that very often. And as I think most of you know by now, he nailed 10 three-pointers against the Blue Bloods from the University of Kentucky. That's one short of the all-time NCAA tournament single-game record, which goes back to 1990, set by Loyola Marymount's Jeff Fryer against Michigan. And because he was so proficient from three, Oakland is advancing after an 80-76 upset of number 3 seed Kentucky Wildcats. So we have, again, we now know who he is. We are now, if you care about the big dance, invested in, well, can he keep going? He made sure to look into the camera after the game to say, we ain't Cinderella. He's saying, why not us? Why not now? They're going to play the out-of-nowhere team, North Carolina State, in the second round of the tournament on Saturday. So my guess is, have you found Pewaukee population? Is it a suburb of Milwaukee?
So Pewaukee has a population of 15,945. That was a couple years ago.
Okay, that's decently healthy, I guess.
Let's see here.
Anything else notable about Pewaukee?
It's around Milwaukee.
Okay.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say that you pronounce his name Gaulke?
Gaulke. Yeah, it's probably Gaulke. Yeah, because everybody's going, Gaulke. Get it?
Yeah.
Ball's going into the basket. It's like a Gaulke. And by the way, he also doesn't start. He's a super sub. Comes off the bench and was ridiculous against a Kentucky team that suddenly is having all sorts of difficulties advancing. And it's the classic story that the only people rooting for Kentucky, literally, are Kentucky fans. And even those who might be on the fence, once they see there's a potential David Goliath upset in the making, suddenly they can't get enough of this Pewaukee kid. They can't get enough of the Oakland story, and that's how it sort of takes off. It's always easy to rip and hate the Blue Bloods. We get that. That's part of the deal. That's part of the fun of the big dance. And when they start showing signs of perhaps being in trouble, being vulnerable, or being beatable, we absolutely love the story. So even that, Wisconsin, I mean, I know we've got some Minnesotans in the tournament, but we have none yet, I don't believe, that have ascended to the level that Jack Golke has after what took place last night. So you haven't spent any time in Pewaukee, you don't think?
I don't. I may have driven through once or twice.
You could have.
But it's possible.
If we have any great Pewaukee minds out there, let me know. Are they dancing in the streets of Pewaukee? Or is it the Sid Hartman thing where they say, well, you left us? It doesn't sound like, literally, this guy, you know, we do the rankings about two-star, three-star, four-star recruit. Apparently, he was a zero-star recruit. Like, nobody had any interest in him. He had to go find himself a place to play. There were zero stars associated with Jack Golke's name.
I've always said close the borders on Pewaukee. You got to keep the kids well, home. You know what I mean? You can't let them go out of town.
Looks like he could have helped you.
He could have.
Although you don't need that many. Wisconsin lately has been shooting very, very well. In any case, that's the, even though there's a couple of interesting developments today, that's your story. And Wisconsin can rightly, you know, claim some ownership to that particular story, now that we have established where indeed he is from. 6'3", played at Pewaukee High School. I guess that shouldn't be surprised. Here's what's the other interesting nugget. He was a senior on the Pewaukee team that handed Tyler Hero, now, of course, a member of the Miami Heat, his final loss in high school. And then, as Milwaukee Journal guy points out, last night he eliminates Hero's college team, the University of Kentucky, as well. I'll give you, well, I'm a little disappointed, in all honesty, because given you're supposed to be a Wisconsin guy, that you're unaware of two other significant sport athletic names that hail from the same town. You don't know, do you?
I should have known.
J.J. and T.J. Watt, Pewaukee. That's a pretty good run for Pewaukee, I got to say. That's
impressive.
Are you
leaving Derek out of this?
Well, that's true. That's another point. I'm told it's pronounced Pewaukee. Is it really? It seems like that would be unsettling to me. If I was the mayor of Pewaukee, I would have serious discussion about, why don't we call it Pewaukee? Pewaukee. You know what I'm saying? But again, who am I to judge? And it's their city. It's their town. We'll come back, set up the rest of the controversial show, including give you the Borton Volvo guest lineup as well. Stay tuned.
Join 9 and Noon's Nordo in the Book Sports Betting Lounge at St. Croix Casino Turtle Lake tomorrow, noon to 2. Stop by and enjoy food and drink specials. Check out his cheat sheet to give you all the best bets for the weekend. KFAN.com keyword calendar for more information.
You're not DVRing all the games as you're listening to us and hoping that you're not going to get details of final scores in the big dance and even partials, because you're about to get pretty much all of that. We've kind of adopted the New Mexico Lobos on this station, or at least on this show. Had Richard Pitino on Sunday. His Lobos improbably making a run through the tournament to get the automatic bid, and apparently they needed to win the tournament to get in. They are, I don't want to say they're dead, but they're hurting right now. At the half, they trail 6-seed Clemson 42 to 28. That's on True TV. By the way, what channel is True TV? Do you know on our TV dial? Let me know if you find a channel.
You know.
I want to switch to that. New Mexico's not as much trouble as Stetson. They're trailing top seed Connecticut, UConn, at the half, 52-19. 52-19. That means UConn is in position to play Northwestern, a 9 seed, next. The Cats go into overtime to knock off Florida Atlantic, 77-65. Baylor destroyed Colgate. Baylor's a 3, 92-67. Brian Dutcher's San Diego State Club holds off UAB, 69-65. Marquette struggled early, but eventually pull away from Western Kentucky, I believe, 87-69 there. I think that kind of brings you up to date. Got a lot of tweets have come in from the Pewaukee community, or people who say they've got a lot of inside knowledge about Pewaukee. Tyler Mason reminding us, indeed, as we mentioned last segment, that he's the hometown of J.J. Watt and his fellow NFL playing brothers, and he linked to a J.J. Watt tweet from last night. Woke up in London to see that a kid from Pewaukee torched Kentucky to lead Oakland in Rochester, Michigan, in a massive 14-3 first-round March Madness upstate. Hell of a performance. Golkey doing the hometown proud. I am getting confirmation that it is Pewaukee. Pewaukee. Channel 917, is that right?
I already switched it for you.
Oh, you did it. Thank you.
Yep.
I didn't know you could do that from there.
Uh-huh.
Impressive. Couple more texts. Much like Pewaukee, you insisted for years I was pronouncing my surname incorrectly. That's from Ojampa. John from Victoria. That's true. Twenty-four-year-olds beating 18-year-olds doesn't have as much Cinderella charm, writes Christian in Rosemont. I'd say if they spent 5 years at a school nobody ever heard of, that it's still fairly charming. I maybe some people do get caught up in that. I think when you factor in, he wasn't like running around from one major program to another. I would say that's not, I doubt that his age in this case is being held against him all that much. Take a look at the Iowa State roster for Pewaukee as well as Minnesota connections. To that point, 651 guy writes, Momchilovic is from Iowa State, but apparently played high school basketball in Pewaukee as well. Milan Momchilovic. That's a hell of a name, is it not? Iowa State, the team's best shooter, and he's only a freshman. So is Pewaukee some kind of a basketball hotbed, and we just didn't know it?
Well, he's only a freshman. He's only 18, so he can't. If he goes up against 24-year-olds, he's going to be in trouble.
Yeah. Hillsdale is an extremely conservative school, so the University of Wisconsin probably wasn't a good fit for Golkey, given its polar opposite. I doubt that that tends to influence all that many basketball players if they're interested in going to the University of Wisconsin because of the basketball program. I could be wrong. Pewaukee is described here as a big sailing lake. Is there a big sailing lake around
it looks
in Pewaukee?
Like
is that what it looks like?
Yeah, it looks like a pretty big lake there.
Summer homes of the Milwaukee Braves players, apparently, back in the day. I bet Gerby has a relative from Pewaukee. That's probably true. So everybody's saying that's the pronunciation, so I guess that's what I'm going to go with. 715 guy writes, it's clear you're not from Wisconsin, Dan. He's saying that I would have known that it's pronounced Pewaukee. Can you spell it? It's P. How is Pewaukee spelled? It's P-E-W-A-U-K-E-E, I'm guessing.
Yeah, it's P-E-Waukee. Yeah.
Described here as a suburb of Waukesha. I'm disappointed in your lack of knowledge. It's your state. You pride yourself on knowing everything about it. I mean, these places don't seem that obscure.
Yeah, I mean, Milwaukee is a place I've not spent a lot of time.
Yeah.
I'm more of a Madison Green Bay guy.
There was another significant story last night that has the replay terrorists beside themselves. And I can't deny that this was an extremely bad call, and that it when a call like that happens as late in the game as it does, you can say it might well have changed the outcome of the game. I don't deny that. I've never denied that that couldn't happen. It doesn't happen as often as people want to think, those replay terrorists who want everything replayed. But it is unfortunate. This goes back to the Kansas-Samford game. Kansas a 4 and Samford a 13. And Kansas looks like they're rolling. But Samford kind of keeps coming. And then they got a chance maybe to steal the damn thing. And they're down 1 when a Kansas guard named Nick Timberlake, seemingly open, like in an open court situation against the press, is going down for a dunk to virtually put the game away. And a defender named A.J. Staten McCray goes up and makes really one of the greatest defensive plays you'll see in a big dance game on any level, in any round. Knocks the ball away, does not foul Timberlake, but the foul is called. And so he gets to go to the line for 2 free throws rather than Samford going back the other direction with the ball down a point. And by the way, 5-on-4. Because the Kansas guy who tried the dunk, Timberlake, he's on the ground. I have every reason to think they're going to, if nothing else, get a good look and maybe even steal the ball game. And I know the coach, Samford coach, I think took the high road, but that's a tough one to take because, again, if it's properly called, we might be talking more about that play saving the game for an underdog more than we're talking about the 10 three-pointers by the pride of Pewaukee, the latest pride of Pewaukee. You know what I'm saying? That was a great, did you see that? That was a great defensive play.
Yeah, it looked like all ball to
me. And it was all ball. There was no body. I could see where a ref would just assume that there must have been contact, but that's not reviewable, at least not yet. But the replay terrorists were handed, I'm not going to deny it, a very, very significant piece of evidence to say something's got to be done. Now, sadly, what is often done, and again, it's already happened in so many games, the number of reviews to check the clock, to check where the ball, who the ball went out of bounds off of, I'm already nauseated by that. I already think, once again, that the game, and that would be my argument, that I will live with even an egregiously bad, heartbreaking call like that rather than have the endless array of replays. And you know, the single most obnoxious, I guess you could say, expression that is now standard in the big dance is several players from each or both teams doing the old index finger in the air, circular motion, like we got to check it. Got to be checked. Got to be checked. Got to check it. Oh, my God. It's nauseating, but that's sort of where we are. The Richard Pitino dream, they're going to have to get tough quick. Early second half, they're down to Clemson now. The lead is up to 17 points. And a lot of people thought New Mexico, even though we were an 11 seed, had a chance maybe to make a little bit of a run. We'll make this the bottom of the hour pause. Keep the inside Pewaukee texts coming. Any more Pewaukee-related background that we can get to. We'll keep an eye on the scores. We'll get to a couple of other big dance items that I think are important for us to discuss. One of them having to do with the anniversary of a big dance game that took place 40 years ago today. Unfortunately, when we come back, we've got to hit the A section pretty hard for at least a few minutes. Two significant breaking stories that will be part of our conversation today. In addition, according to the Borton Volvo guest lineup, the Friday regulars, Ben Gessling will join at 4:30, and Lavelle, the Twins' chief lickspittle, will join us at 5:30.
American rockers A Day to Remember are bringing their The Least Anticipated Album Tour to the Ledge Amphitheater June 6th with special guests The Story So Far and 4 years Strong. Tickets go on sale this Friday. That's today, 10 a.m. But head over to KFAN.com, keyword calendar, for more information.
Ben Gessling to talk all things National Football League at 4:30, and on the Borton Volvo scorecard today, we expect Lavelle at the usual time, 5:30. May go to a big dance, listen in at some point, maybe a couple of times during this program. There's nothing very dramatic going on right now. UConn's up on Stetson 57-24, and Clemson is up on New Mexico 51-32, 4 minutes into the second half. I really selfishly was hoping Richard Pitino was going to make at least even a modest run so he could continue to kind of be our eyes and ears. Maybe I can convince him, if they do get eliminated, to be our unofficial unpaid analyst about whatever else is happening in the tournament. That would be kind of fun as well. I don't want to, push my luck with him, because he's obviously there now. He's not here now, but we always enjoy chatting with him. While the big dance is going on, the A section doesn't stop. It continues to the real world revolve. And in this case, with some tragic implications. First, the story breaking out of London, England, that the Princess of Wales, Catherine, reveals she's been diagnosed with cancer and that she was in the early stages of chemotherapy. I'm reading from a Washington Post story on the subject. She is asking for time, space, and privacy while completing treatment. The news came as a huge shock. She said in a pre-recorded message that was posted today on X and broadcast on the BBC, "William and I have been doing everything we can to process and manage this privately for the sake of our young family." She said that after she underwent major abdominal surgery in January, she thought her condition was non-cancerous. That surgery, described as successful, tests after the operation apparently found that cancer indeed had been present. She said that she was well and getting stronger every day. This was her first public comments following months of speculation about her health. She had not made an official public appearance since Christmas. And at that time, Kensington Palace had said that she had successful abdominal surgery and would not resume her official duties until after Easter. That's getting a pretty good amount of attention. To the point where, of course, when anybody is out of the public eye, as long as she is, or was, or had been, the conspiracy theories apparently start piling up as well, memes about her well-being. And this, in part, I think, prompted an attempt to, end the noise, quell the frenzy. So the palace releases a photo showing her 42 and her three children on Mother's Day in Britain. Problem was, news agencies pulled the photo, citing concerns that it was altered. In a note posted to social media attributed to Catherine, she apologized for editing the photo. There was much discussion about that. You'll recall, in February, Buckingham Palace announced that King Charles III was diagnosed with cancer. Palace has not revealed what type of cancer he has, only that he is receiving treatment. Then there's the story still ongoing out of Moscow. I had reached out to our counterterror big knocker, Mike Hurley. He dined his own to get his quick reaction to this story in particular. But he is extremely tied up the next day or two with some business things. So we'll maybe get him on to talk about this story. Maybe we'll know more about it at that point, and then maybe get back to some Middle East stuff with him as well at some point early next week before I take a few days off. This is, as I said, Dateline Moscow. Several gunmen opened fire tonight at Crocus City Hall, a popular concert venue on the outskirts of Moscow, according to Russian state news agencies. Dozens of people were reported injured or killed. The building on fire. I believe the latest count I heard was at least 40 dead, but I think this is one of those cases where the number is going to move around quite a bit and probably get worse. People in camouflage, at least three, burst into the ground floor of the Crocus City Hall and opened fire from automatic weapons. There are definitely wounded. That was according to the state news agency, citing its correspondent on site. After that, they threw a grenade or an incendiary bomb, which started a fire. The people in the hall lay down on the floor to escape the shooting, stayed there for 15 to 20 minutes, after which they began to crawl out, many managing to get out. You may recall, latest details in this Washington Post story is at least 40 killed, more than 100 wounded. But that's all, that's from through official channels, which may or may not be accurate. One graphic video showed a shooter opening fire for a full minute at point-blank range on a group of people trapped in an entranceway. Other clips showing scores of bodies slumped on benches or on the ground, as well as a massive fire erupting from the building's roof. To my knowledge, there have been no immediate claims of responsibility in this case. Unclear whether there's any connection between this attack and the Russia's invasion of Ukraine, a war that's now into its third year. Some of you may recall that just within the last few weeks, a number of foreign embassies, including, I think, the U.S., had issued warnings urging their citizens to avoid mass gatherings because of the risk of attacks. And to that point, find my phone here because I saved this particular item. To that point, I'm looking at a headline. I don't know what publication this was in. Putin recently dismissed U.S. warning of potential terrorist attacks in Moscow. March 19th, the Russian president dismissed warnings from U.S. diplomats that there was an imminent risk of a terrorist attack at a crowded venue in Moscow. The president, a Russian president, calling the warnings outright blackmail by the West in an attempt to intimidate and destabilize our society. That was apparently just within the last few days. So that obviously did not age very well at all. So we'll keep an eye on it. A couple of people have already texted saying some of the video is very graphic. Have you seen some of it? Is it?
I just got a little taste.
Yeah, it's not good. It's not good. To this point, I don't think there's been any official or unofficial claim of responsibility in this case, but it looks like an absolutely horrible, sordid scene. Bradshaw and Brian, KFAN text line is 64686. Let's do this. Let's pause. Let's get an early pause in here. Get ahead of it a bit. Get some more reaction. We'll keep you posted on some toy department stuff as well, including the latest scores in the big dance. Ben Gessling in about 45 minutes.